Hello. I am not animated this week. I thought that it might be fun to do a little bit of a longer form story and honestly give my hand a little bit of a break. So this week is going to be a campaign diary of a new set of characters who I think are probably about to wipe. If you have any handy tips on how that's not going to happen, that would be great. And if you just came here for animation, there is some art in this episode, but maybe this one isn't for you. And don't worry, I'll be animated again next week. All right, let's do it. A rickety carriage grinds up the cold road. Its occupants try and sit, bouncing wildly on velvet seats, cursing Shifty Wick. It was his fault they were in these godforsaken mountains. They were personally sent by Clearbrum, the unmasked lord, to capture Wick. The official charge was slander, but Sweet Willem, Dave, and Wades in Shadows knew the truth. Wick had stolen a piece of Helgar's spear, a terrifying artifact whose value is only outstripped by its potential to destabilize the entirety of Faerûn. William and the Dragonborn had managed to capture him too, 7 times. Say what you want about Wick, but he's a slippery motherfucker. So far, Wick framed another Kenku, turned Sweet William's raven against him, ambushed the team with Wade's old enemies, the Ulrith Nar, and in one particularly brutal escape, he cut off all their legs. The restoration was not cheap. In the past 6 months chasing Wick, they've been humiliated, imprisoned twice, framed for burning down an inventor's workshop, lost more than 3,000 gold, a coat of warmth, Wade's cherished blink arrow, Willem's invisible dagger, and more horses than they can count, a war goat, and not to mention their two companions, Zir and Ulka, leaving only 2 Dragonborn left on the team. Every night, they collectively traded hateful tales of the Kenku thief, and every day, they rattled farther and farther north. They spent most of their remaining gold on an expert driver and a carriage. That's when they came upon it, a familiar war goat. Wick's mount, frozen to the ground. They told their driver to stop the cart. Sweet William took point and jumped out of the carriage. He checked it. Wick wasn't there, but he'd left his saddlebags, obviously in a hurry. His tracks were already fading. Willem opened up the bags and heard a chk. He spotted a trap wire.
Oh, God!
The goat exploded like some kind of grotesque fragmentation grenade. The cart was hit with a wave of frozen gristle, and when it bounced back to level, Wade popped his head out of the window.
Find anything good?
He made a perception check 18. He saw a tiny speck of gray against the white snow. Wick had a good 5-hour head start, but they had a cart. The driver knew the area pretty well and pointed out that Wick was about to hit Horseshoe Canyon. Its center was a town, but that was a good 10 hours on foot. They'd catch Wick in 3. And so they took off. The horses warded against the cold, the wheels mending themselves, and the driver in a state somewhere between fury and bliss. After 2 hours, they caught up with Wick, shuffling towards the edge of the canyon. Wade climbed to the roof of the cart and took out his bow. He was going to wing the little rat in the leg if he could. That's when he noticed one of the nearby snow mounds shift and move. A full-grown winter wolf with a pack of pups, getting ready for the kill. This presented a dilemma. They could let the wolf have her meal and this would all be over. They probably wouldn't be able to recover the artifact and maybe wouldn't get the reward, but he'd be dead. Or they could save Wick. Dave leaned out of the back of the cart, his scales bristling in the freezing wind, and he started to play his war drum like a goddamn champion. He conjured up the illusion of a dragon silently slinking over the side of the canyon. The winter wolves were terrified and started dispersing. Just then, there was a rumbling noise, coming from down below. Wade looked over as Wick spread his arms wide and started tilting over the edge. Kenku cannot fly, but Wick seems to have found a loophole. Do you remember the inventor's workshop from earlier? The Kenku spread his haphazardly strapped vellum wings, and they filled with an updraft. Wick closed his eyes and began to fly. Well, glide. Then from the chasm, another thunderous rumble erupted. Under the cart, ice began to crack and tilt. Dave yelled, "Oh, we got a big boy," and they did. The same illusion that scared away the wolves lured something much, much worse. It had a head the size of a tavern and a body to match. The monstrosity scrambled after the cart, screaming out strikes of thunder and lightning that split the ground. Sweet William leaned out the window, looked back at the enormous reptilian thing, and then forward to see Wick gently gliding towards the quaint hunter's village of Horseshoe Town. William knocked an arrow, aimed low to catch the draft, and in a moment of pure being, narrowed his perception to a single point, the base of Wick's foot. Then, released. Nat 20, sneak attack, non-lethal. The arrow threaded up Wick's leg and it split open like a watermelon, tendons whipping like tassels in the wind. Wick went limp. Choosing non-lethal just means they don't have to stabilize to live. It doesn't mean they stay conscious. They wanted Wick to live, 50-50 chance of Wick surviving in one piece. 65, he hit the other side of the canyon, slid down, and settled 50 feet down on a small outcropping of ice. Thank God, I guess? I don't know. Dave took a second look at the terror that was chasing them and remembered. Something any bronze dragonborn might, a children's tale of the monsters which giants wrought and dragons killed. This was a proto-Bahir, and not just any Bahir, Gragnall the Strained, one of the oldest and most flawed. Hit it behind the knees, Dave yelled. Wade was immediately on it. He waited for an opening, and the Bahir obliged. Just a flash, showing the juicy soft spot at the back of its bloated little leg. He fired and hit. The whole animal shuddered in pain and started gliding back and slid back down the chasm. The team was safe, but they had to make it to Horseshoe Village before the little bastard got away again, and it was a nerve-wracking 3-hour drive. They'd finally gotten him. I mean, maybe this time. And they were all terrified that I'd pull a dick DM move and the Kenku just wouldn't be there when they arrived. And they were only half right. The team eventually made it to the hunting village. The smell of oiled furs and sour meat hung over the place. It was more of a camp than a town, with a few sheds, but the only permanent structure was a massive cylindrical longhouse tavern. After parking the cart, the driver hopped out and started walking towards the tavern. Willem cut him off.
Jim, good job out there. While you're in the tavern, could you pick up some food and some supplies for us?
Willem put 5 gold into Jim's hand.
What? You know, supplies, food, potions.
You realize I'm a driver, right? Not like a servant.
Oh, well, yeah.
Wade slid into the conversation.
Very good work back there. Thank you. We are in your debt.
And palmed him a couple extra coins.
Jim turned around and started towards the tavern.
I'll do my best.
The team started asking around, assuming Wick must have gotten into town by now, but nobody really had seen him except for Father Grigor Brum, a priest who directed them to the south of town and invited Dave to join him later and talk over matters of spirit. Dave, believing Father Brum had access to some kind of divine insight, was more than happy to oblige, but finding Wick was a little more pressing. After searching the edges of Horseshoe Town, they eventually found his pathetic little body.
And as Wick took in ragged, shallow breaths, Dave rigged up some pitons and rope from Wade's pack.
When he lowered down, Wick looked up at him pleadingly and extended a small hand.
Yeah, I'm here to save you, but you've got a lot to answer for when we get up there.
They dragged Wick up to the town, plopped him on the ground. As it happened so many times before, it became clear that Wick had stowed the spearhead somewhere. Wick pointed at his bag. Wade grabbed it and looked inside. There was a blink arrow, an invisible dagger, and a set of 4 cigars, each with a different colored band. Wick pointed at the black banded cigar. Wade, knowing not to trust Wick with anything from the pack, inspected the cigars more closely.
Each cigar had language on it and herbs within it, which suggested particular schools of magic.
The black band was clearly some kind of healing cigar. The yellow, abjuration, green, conjuration, and the blue, he couldn't tell.
No, no, no.
Wade pocketed the cigars.
It's not time to celebrate yet.
Dave slapped Wick and yelled, "Where's the spear?" Before Wick had time to answer, punched him again. Wick went limp. They took the opportunity to tie the Kenku up. Then, Dave pulled out a dulcimer and started noodling out a rendition of Tabaxi in the Cradle that would bring an outlander to tears. And to the beat of every pluck, the Kenku's splayed nub curled back into a shape that almost resembled a leg, and Wick opened his eyes, then looked at the ropes. Kenku can't speak, but can only mimic sounds they've heard, and as this Kenku hadn't heard much speech for a while, he started with what he knew.
The spear! Yeah, I'm here to save you, but the spear! You've got a lot to answer for when we get up there.
A little baffled, the team took a second to take that in.
Then they realized that they had to start feeding him vocabulary to get the info they needed. As they started shouting out random bits and bobs, Willem started going through Wick's additional bags. He found 2 gold bars and a heart-shaped locket. Hungry for a little more info on the little bastard, Willem popped the locket open. There was a clap and a burst of thick smoke. Con saves all around. Openly rolled, Wick aced his. But of course, Wade, Dave, and Willem got knocked out. They woke up 2 hours later, cold and Kenku-less. His hobbled tracks led back to the outcropping he'd been unconscious on. They got ready to climb down on their pythons from before, but double-checked them, Wicked loosened them in case he was followed. Finally, they knocked the pythons back in deeper and climbed down to inspect it. He had hit the spear in the snow down there. There was a little wedge where he had taken it out. And so, the search for Wick began again. After much tent searching, Wade pretended to look for his
grandma.
And Dave, of course, thick as a brick, just kept yelling, Wick! They gave up and went into the tavern, where Jim greeted them with two capes made out of rats, three vials of 1d4 healing potions, and 4 gold's worth of limes.
That's a lot of limes.
They eventually found someone who had seen the Kenku talking to one of the frost goblins who lived in a cave nearby. They also learned from the local law enforcement it was basically open season on the gobos, and the local poison maker would buy their salivary glands, prized for their ability to make wraith oil, a blade oil used against incorporeal creatures. They had learned the frost goblins had a soft spot at the back of their head, which is essentially like an off switch. Think a Seagal movie, basically. They also knew the frost goblins had apparently been getting smarter, obsessing over some kind of dig, coming into town to sell strange, often cursed items, and now not coming into town at all and being extremely aggressive to the residents. The team waited on the edge of town, looking down on another ledge that led from the cliffside into the goblin's cave, waiting for an opening in between guards. When he left, they started moving into the caves in search of Wick. Unfortunately, Dragonborn don't have night vision, and each Dragonborn had a different solution to this problem. Wade's in shadows, well, he did as his name suggests, which was essentially groped around in the dark, keeping his lantern hooded at almost all times. Whereas Dave, well, he just popped out his lantern and happily roamed the halls, which of course eventually backfired. Three goblins sat in a circle, rolling strange dice. Each time they hit the ground, the dice would flash with bright, searing light. The goblins cheered and tallied up scores. Suddenly, while one of them was mid-toss, a different kind of light shone down the hall, and they heard as Dave's lantern clanged against the wall. They jumped to their feet, one started screaming for help, and Dave ran forward, opened his maw, and let loose a crack of lightning, which killed the other two instantly. The third ran full tilt down the hall and managed to bypass both Wade and Willem. They fired off a few shots, but they missed. Wade accidentally used his blink arrow and teleported himself into a goblin's cooking fire. The goblin next to him, a different one than the screamer, stabbed him and then also stumbled into the fire. In agony, Wade took this opportunity to grab the poor little guy by his feet and swing him into the cave wall. The goblin hit the wall with a crunch and then sizzled as his limp body hit the floor. The team went running after the alarm goblin, but he got away, and so they decided, you know what, stealth screwed up, we're gonna set up an ambush. But what they didn't realize is they hadn't finished clearing out the first fork of the cavern. When the goblins finally came, they did so in force. A warlock frost goblin at the head of a flank of 5 goblins with javelins. Then from behind their ambush, another 4 goblins from the fork that was not cleared out earlier. And they came with their own javelins. The team was stuck. All 3 of them got porcupined in the first round. And then as the goblins went to retrieve their javelins, Sweet Willem killed the warlock, clearly their leader. Wade spun around, opened up his lantern, and temporarily blinded the other 4 as they launched their volley. And finally, Dave created an illusion of a dwarf in the hopes of soaking up some of the damage, but it wasn't enough. 3 rounds later, they'd blown through all of their healing potions, Wade had 3 HP, Dave was down, and Sweet Willem had 5 HP left. The frost goblins were all retreating back to their javelin piles to get another volley, and from the darkness they heard, "You've got a lot to answer for when we get up there." And that's where we left the session off. This is my current campaign. If you have any suggestions on how the hell the players are going to survive, tell me. Because I'm pretty sure I can only think of about 5 ways that don't involve me cheesing rolls. All right, so since this is a little bit longer form, I can speak without reading off of the script, which is why you might hear that I have a different cadence. But I wanted to, very honestly, I just wanted to say thank you. I know I'm not winning an Oscar or anything, but I get to tell my goofy stories for a living, and it's been a blast, and just thank you so much for all the support and for watching the videos. Thanks a lot, and I'll see you guys next week, but I'll be animated as usual. See you in the next animated spellbook, or tome, or sword, or whatever it's going to be. There are going to be some links in the description, more info about the campaign and the players who run some of their own D&D stuff.